1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
I feel it in my fingers. I feel it in my toes.
You're doing it f***ing wrong.
Love is all around me, and so the feeling grows.
Yeah! No! You had it there at the beginning, Ron.
I don't think it was any great visions, just four blokes from Andover that got together.
With who we are, our straw sticking out their ears, had come to London and kicked the ass out of the business.
As individual musicians, we're probably not the best in the world, but we produce an interesting noise together.
But don't expect f***ing miracles just like that.
And it was a good place, actually, to be in a group in Andover, more so than, say, in Basingstoke.
You're a big pranny.
Basingstoke wasn't really on the map regarding groups, but Andover was a really swinging place for groups.
I was strolling down the sidewalk with my girl by my side when a great big hunk of fella came and pushed me aside. I said, hey, bud, I suppose you think it's some kind of joke.
I think the fact that they come from Hampshire and have this accent which everybody in Britain who comes from a big city thinks is intrinsically amusing is, you know, another aspect of their charm.
Next thing I remember, he was jumping on my throat.
So we really started delving into old record stores to find out if there was some kind of music there that we might like, because the Stones and the Kinks and the Small Faces were starting up with good heavy riffs and everything, and we found it in the old 40s blues sort of music.
I think that Reg had an interest in blues music, but it wasn't that deep, and I think that they either consciously or unconsciously were,
this is radio,
influenced, not, may not be quite the right word, but certainly affected by the beat boom that had been going for the previous 2 or 3 years.
12 to 3, the DLT lunchtime show.
The Kinks, yeah, we used to play the Kinks numbers, Rolling Stones numbers. We used to copy everybody.
I didn't listen, and never have listened to the radio as much as an ordinary, say, punter does, because I felt that if I listened too closely to what was on, I would write exactly what was on.
We were really struggling in those days. Money was tight. Reg was taking days off to go to London.
We were sounding pretty potent at that time. You get an inner feeling that if you're given the right chance, that you could do it.
I liked him because he was talking like that all the time. You know, we were writing some songs, and I mean, I loved it.
Guy at Page One Records, in actual fact it was Dick James Music, they were all in the same building, Dennis Berger, had a copy of an old demo that had been around the business for ages, and he sent it to Larry. It literally run to the next office and said, I think your boys should try to do this, you know, and it was a number called Wild Thing.
And I just broke down and cried. I said, that'll never be a hit, it's bloody...
It was extremely important within what happened with the Troggs. I think he was a planner.
The only way we were going to achieve what I wanted to achieve was, again, for me to have total control.
Larry Page phoned me up. He said, I'm a bit worried about the lead singer. His name is Reginald Morris Bowles. He said, now what can I call him? And I just said, oh, Presley, for a joke on the phone. He said, that's great. I said, no, I was only kidding. You know, he said, no, Reg Presley's great. I'm going to call him Presley.
And I thought, oh my God, you know. Couldn't they thought of a less known name like Crosby or Sinatra, you know?
For somebody called Reg, who looked like that, to call himself Presley was as splendid an act of defiance as it was for a geek in glasses to call himself Elvis.
Larry Page wanted the Troggs because he'd lost the Kinks amid much acrimony in a court case, and he wanted a group to replace them.
He had us tied up virtually as everything, management agency, record company, music publishing company.
Well, we did query it at one time and they said that it'd be better if
all your affairs were in one building, so you won't have to keep going asking other people.
You can see his logic. On the other hand, I think a modern-day music business lawyer would say that the concentration of power could lead to corruption and a conflict of interest.
We didn't even get a say in it. Wham, it was in the can. Regardless, you reckon that was bad? He used to, you know, I mean, one take, that's it, finish. We said,
As for messing up the deal in America, to have a number one record in the US on two different labels was a complete disaster.
I mean, you can't, in a way, I suppose, blame anybody for that. I mean, you're trying to get a record off. It's a big country, it's a good market, so you want to do the best thing. But he gave it to two guys and said, I'll give you 6 weeks to do something with it. And these guys went out to America, back to America, and in about 5 weeks and 5 days went by, and he thought, well, they're not going to do anything now with it, and went ahead and did another deal with somebody else by then.
So both records went to number one. Joint number ones, two Troggs Wild Things.
One of the biggest fiascos in mid-60s pop, and it obviously affected the Troggs and determined their actions thereafter, especially when the B-side happens to be the song that is going to be the follow-up.
I want to spend my
Larry Page said we weren't ready for the States, or the States weren't ready for us.
It's one thing saying, I want to go to America, then it's another thing saying, I want to earn money. So which do you want to do? Ideally, you want to go to America and earn money. So therefore, it's down to getting the timing right.
I can see why Larry Page would have thought that was the right decision at the time, that they weren't ready, because a lot of people had gone to the States and totally blown it. But you could also see how the Troggs would have thought that they'd missed their big chance.
He's obviously got a musical talent because he plays the bass.
Bass was great for me, especially in the learning stage, because you'd go round half the keyboard trying to find a note, and you'd find some great riffs trying to do that, you know. So, and when you think about it, a lot of bass players I've written throughout the years. Paul McCartney, Sting.
Oh, no!
Reg's songwriting used to come up and say, so I've got this song, it goes... So we used to sit down and sit down and work out, you know, what Reg was trying to get through to us.
Your slacks are low and your hips are showing.
Usually, when I get the riff, the lyric line usually comes along with it. You know, you see the tune and you get something of the words. You might get three words out of, say, eight. Then you build it. And build it, and build it. And usually, with me, I go over a verse, time and time and time.
Totally lunkish and gormless. If they'd been pretty, it would have been intolerable.
Everything is sexuality. Everything you were selling was sex.
That was a part of our act, you know, to try to be sexy, you know, if we actually achieved it at all times or made ourselves look right plonkers, I don't know, but maybe it was to sort of compensate for our not play, you know, such clever music.
Reg Presley was a figure of great comedy in a sense. He had a certain macho sexuality, but it was a comic sexuality.
Convenient way of ending the song. We didn't think it sounded like an orgasm at all.
I can't control myself. I can't control myself, baby.
Larry Page used to try to get us to do things, but if it wasn't within our capabilities or we didn't like it, then, you know, we just wouldn't do it.
If it's love that you want, baby, you've got it. From the depth of my soul, baby, you've got it.
at your game.
The artists were, you know, the people which come up with the goods, but the managers used to take a lot of the credit.
Any way that you want me.
The sound, you know, was quite influenced by Larry, particularly initially.
Who would you say created the Troggs sound?
I've got to say me, haven't I? Okay, cut.
He takes a lot of credit for it, doesn't he? He tries to take a lot of credit.
He's actually tried to rewrite the history of the Troggs.
Frank Sinatra, the Beach Boys, Elvis Presley, Roy Orbison, I'd say Stones, Beatles. Oh, the competition was enormous. And to actually get to number one, competing against these people, when I think back, it was, you know, quite remarkable.
We were releasing, as one record came down the chart, another one was going up, and that's the way they did it for some reason in the 60s. They just went up and down, and as long as they could keep that going, you stayed in the chart. I mean, 42 weeks in the chart in that first year. We were a long time to be in the chart.
Give it to me, give it to me.
If you've got a band and they're earning £10 and you say, right, my commission is £1 out of that, they go, oh, okay. But you never do, funnily enough. You do, you always say, well, don't worry about that. But if you say, okay, £1, they're happy. If you say you've earned £1,000, therefore £100, they go, okay. If it's £10,000, you say, £1,000, oh, that's mine. They go, he's getting a bloody lot. All he did was make a phone call.
I don't think any precedent had been set regarding royalties and things like that.
They would get a gig in the Olympia, Paris. They say they got £2,000 for it, whatever it may be. They would all take a suite at the George Sank. They would all be whining and dining, you know, for all the night away. And they come back and they'd owe money. And then they blame the manager because they've all done their money overnight.
I don't like Larry Page very much, so I don't really want to talk about him very much. I'd rather not talk about him at all, actually.
I walk along in dreams. I cannot feel, I cannot see. The only thing I know is that you're...
We didn't go into drugs at all. It was around us all the time. Used to have an American road manager who used to be driving along smoking his joint. Which now I think is a little bit dangerous now I think of it. And we used to make him blow all the smoke out the car window as we was going along because we didn't want all the smoke coming back and making us high.
Any record that you ever did, if it mentioned the word grass then, it was, oh, we're going to have to listen to that. And I suppose they had a board of listeners that listened to it and said, right, strike it out. I mean, I wrote a song. Somebody said, well, see, man, you know, but they said to me, to be able to write these sort of things, you've got to be on LSD. I said, you reckon, do you? So I wrote this song, you know, bamboo butterflies, twice their normal size, flying around in my mind. Visions new to me drift on endlessly, driving me out of my mind into the night. And all this, you know, and I said, I wrote that with a cup of tea.
I'm only left with misty dreams here in my mind.
Larry would sit them down and say, look, I don't want this, this is the image I want. I don't want you to be like the Rolling Stones. There's too much drugs in pop music at the moment. He had Chris Britton leaving the Troggs, claiming that he was leaving because he was taking a stand against drugs in pop music. Chris Britton didn't even know about this until it had been fairly well advanced. And he's saying, no, no, you don't say anything. And then finally, he has stage-managed Chris arriving at the airport and telling Dave Wright of the Loot, who is his temporary replacement, that he's changed his mind and he's coming back and it's everybody's happily ever after.
I got called to the record company's office one day and they just said that we're going to replace you. I said, oh.
I feel it in my fingers, I feel it in my toes. Well, love is all around.
Pete was in his own world. I mean, he wasn't really cut out for rock and roll.
All the breath was taken out of me, because I'd only been married a couple of months, and, you know, then they came out with this.
So if you really love me, come on and let it show.
We came off the stage one night. This was like the straw that broke the camel's back. We came off one night and said, what happened with a girl like you? And he said, well, we'd already done it. And he said, well, we hadn't, you know. There's three other guys saying, we didn't do With a Girl Like You at that point. So he played With a Girl Like You to something else, you know. So where was his mind at, you know?
I see your face before me as I lay on my bed.
The boys went in the studio to do some recording while I was on honeymoon, and they got another bass player in. They must have thought, well, you know, he's a lot better than Pete, this bloke is, so, you know, we'll keep him.
Got to a point where we couldn't handle it, and we thought it'd be, you know, best to part company.
I need someone beside me in everything I do.
When he had the choice of going into rock and roll or settling down happily, which is what he did.
Oh, I love you, I always will. My mind's made up by the way that I feel.
Left a horrible taste in my mouth, and for a long, long time I didn't want anything to do with it at all. It was such a shock to me. I just didn't want to know anything about the music industry at all.
It's everywhere I go.
There's a certain point that you get to when in this business. Drink, drugs, anything you want is easily accessible to you if you want them. Ronnie went on, he didn't say no, he didn't listen to the bells, and he enjoyed himself to the full, and he's a casualty.
I think when they got a little bit desperate towards the end of their run of hit records, there was some real rubbish they recorded. But I think they were game to try anything at that stage.
That is a number one, and if that bastard don't go, then you I'll retire.
It's one of the great and marvellous ironies of pop that Reg Presley is going to go down now as one of the country's most successful songwriters, in the sense that he's written two number one records, With a Girl Like You in 66 and Love Is All Around.
It's written on the wind, it's everywhere I go.
I think there comes a time with a band that has been relatively successful over a short period, like the Troggs, when newer bands come in.
I know I love you, I always will. My mind's made up by the way that I feel. There's no beginning.
The single greatest contribution to the legend of the Troggs is the Troggs tape.
You've got to put a little bit of fairy dust over the bastard.
That, I think, kept their name alive and cemented the affection that a lot of people feel for them, to almost to a greater extent than any of their real releases.
Ronnie, just listen for a sec.
They dragged us in there. I had embryos of ideas in my head, nothing to go by.
Well, just shut your mouth for 5 minutes and give me a chance to do it. Don't keep racking down that microphone.
And normally we do all our arguments in somebody's garage or in the local village hall or something.
You're a big pranny.
We started working and they left the tape running and the arguments just came out as they would in the garage.
Why don't you just do what you started out doing dubba 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 cha.
Sometimes perfection makes a thing stale. If you get something too correct, then it's wrong. Because life isn't absolutely correct, and it's the difference of the chaos in life that makes life interesting.
You did it in the beginning. Bloody hell, I can't play with that.